Hello and welcome everyone. Today I'll be continuing with the topic pathologies of the uterus, wherein I'll be covering the topics malignant mixed Müllerian tumor and endometrial stromal tumors very briefly, followed by tumors of the myometrium, of which leiomyoma is very important, and also leiomyosarcoma. So let's start. So first is malignant mixed Müllerian tumor. So as the name suggests, it is malignant tumor of the uterus which is mixed in nature. Mixed means it is a carcinosarcoma. It has both the component of carcinoma and sarcoma. So before telling you what is carcinoma and sarcoma, I would like to tell you that carcinomas, they arise from malignant epithelial tissue. So what is epithelial tissue? The lining of our body cavities, the lining of surface, the surface epithelial linings, they all are the epithelial component of the body. And these, when they turn malignant, then they give rise to carcinomas. And what are sarcomas? The mesenchymal component of the body, which is mainly the connective tissue. Connective tissue composed of smooth muscle cells, skeletal muscle cells, adipose tissue, all that is the mesenchymal tissue in the body. It forms the structural framework of the body. And the malignant tumors which arise from these mesenchymal tissues, they are known as sarcomas. So malignant mixed Müllerian tumor is a carcinosarcoma because it has malignant component arising from both the epithelial tissue like the endometrium and the mesenchymal tissue, that is the stroma and the myometrium. So this is the meaning of mixed Müllerian tumor. So malignant mixed Müllerian tumors, also referred to as carcinosarcomas, they will have endometrial adenocarcinomas along with the malignant mesenchymal component. So from where will the mesenchymal component arise in the uterus? So first source is stroma. The cells of the stroma can turn malignant and they can give rise to the sarcomatous component. And secondly, myometrium. Myometrium is composed of smooth muscle cells. So they can turn malignant and they can give rise to the sarcomatous component of malignant mixed Müllerian tumor. So malignant mixed Müllerian tumor will have two components. One is carcinomatous, that will arise from the endometrium, endometrial lining, and the other will be the sarcomatous component, which will arise either from the stroma or from the cells of the myometrium. So the epithelial and stromal components in a MMT, it is derived from the same founding cell. So the original cell is the same, and it gives rise to both the carcinomatous component as well as the sarcomatous component. So in the morphology, so the malignant mixed Müllerian tumors, they are bulky and polypoid grossly. So in this picture you can see there is a polypoid tumor. This is the tumor. This is the uterus cut longitudinally, and its cavity, endometrial cavity, it is filled with this tumor. So you can see this is the tumor, which is bulky and polypoid in nature. And in the histopathology we will see two components. First is adenocarcinoma, that is the epithelial component, which will be mixed with the mesenchymal component or sarcomatous component. So in this picture you see these are the glands have lumen in the center. So these are the glands which are lined by the atypical epithelial cells. So this is the malignant glands. These are the malignant glands, variable in size. And here you can see that the stromal cells, they have also turned atypical. So they are also malignant here in the stroma. This is a difference from the endometrial adenocarcinoma, where only the glandular component was malignant. But here you can see the stroma is also having malignant cells. So this is the microscopy of malignant mixed Müllerian tumor. Now next, tumor of the endometrial stroma. So endometrial stroma give rise to neoplasms, and that those tumors, they resemble the normal stromal cells of the endometrium. And endometrial stromal neoplasm, they are divided into some categories. First is benign stromal nodules, which arise from the stromal cells of the endometrium, and they are benign and they don't even invade the myometrium. And other category is endometrial stromal sarcomas, which can be either low grade or high grade. These endometrial stromal neoplasms are due to certain chromosomal aberrations, and about half of the stromal sarcomas, they recur. They have a poor prognosis, and relapse rates are also high, and they range from 36% to more than 80%, depending on the stage of the endometrial stromal sarcoma. Now next we come to the tumors of the myometrium. This is very important. So tumors of the myometrium can be divided into two categories. First is benign tumors of the myometrium. they are called leiomyomas, and the malignant tumors arising from the myometrium, they are called leiomyosarcomas. So if in our body, if benign tumor arises from smooth muscle cell, it is called leiomyoma. In case of uterus, we will call it uterine leiomyoma. While if the smooth muscle cell, it turns malignant, then it will be called leiomyosarcoma. So what is uterine leiomyoma? Uterine leiomyoma, in common language, we call it fibroid. It is one of the most common tumor in women. It is a benign smooth muscle neoplasm. So it is benign in nature. It is well encapsulated tumor, and it arises from the smooth muscles of the myometrium, and neoplasm means they are proliferating. So basically the smooth muscle cells in the myometrium layer of uterus, they are proliferating in leiomyoma. They can be either single or they can be multiple. In this picture, this is a longitudinal section of a uterus cut open, and it shows multiple leiomyomas. All these are the leiomyomas. They are even filling the endometrial cavity. They are compressing it. So leiomyoma is also known as myoma. In the pathogenesis of leiomyoma, so there are certain cytogenetic abnormalities that are seen in 40% of the cases of leiomyoma. So mutation in certain genes are seen, like HMGIC, HMGIY and MED1-2 genes. There is also role of estrogen and progesterone that has been proposed because of certain features of leiomyoma. Like this leiomyoma occurs in reproductive age group. It is less common in postmenopausal women. Then during pregnancy, the size of leiomyoma increases. So there is certain receptors for the steroid hormones that which are present in the proliferating myometrial cells. Now next we come to the sites of occurrence. So depending on the site of occurrence, we divide the leiomyomas into three categories. So first is intramural. Intramural are the leiomyomas which are occurring in the myometrium, which are seen in the myometrium, which are like this. These are the intramural fibroids, this and this. These are surrounded all around by the normal myometrium. So these are intramural. If they are seen just beneath the endometrium, then they are called submucosal. So this is endometrium, and the leiomyomas which are present just beneath the endometrial lining, they are called submucosal. Submucosal leiomyoma or submucosal fibroid. So submucosal fibroid can either be sessile, means without any stalk, or if it has a stalk, then it is called pedunculated submucosal fibroid. Then the third category of fibroids is called subserosal fibroids. So subserosal fibroids, they are seen just beneath the serosa or the perimetrium. So this is the subserosal fibroids. Subserosal fibroid, it is seen just below the perimetrium. And subserosal fibroid, also like this submucosal fibroid, they can be either sessile. Sessile means without a stalk, or they can be pedunculated with a stalk. This is subserosal pedunculated fibroid. So the submucosal fibroids and subserosal fibroids, they can be pedunculated. They can have a stalk. And there is one interesting point that subserosal pedunculated fibroids, they can become parasitic or wandering leiomyomas. So in some cases, what occurs, what happens, the pedunculate, the stalk becomes very thin, and this leiomyoma gets detached from its original site, and it wanders in the peritoneal cavity, and it can get attached to some other surface in the peritoneum and receive its blood supply from that area. So in that case, it is called parasitic leiomyoma and or wandering leiomyoma. So these are the complications of subserosal pedunculated fibroids. It can become a wandering leiomyoma, and later on it can get implanted at some other site in the peritoneal cavity and derive its blood supply from that area. Then it is called parasitic leiomyoma. So this is the classification of leiomyoma based on its location in the uterus. Now this picture, again to make you understand the different types of leiomyomas based on the anatomical position. So this one is pedunculated subserous. Then this is again subserous because it is just below the perimetrium, and it is also obstructing the fallopian tube, and it can result in infertility. It can cause a complication of infertility. So this is submucosal and pedunculated. Again, this is submucosal. This is cervical. This is in the cervix. Then this is subserous. So these are the different types of fibroids. Now again, these are the different pictures of uterus. So here there is a longitudinal section of uterus. Here you can see different types of fibroid. Like this is submucosal. These two are submucosal fibroids. Then this is subserosal fibroid. Subserosal fibroid. This is a laparoscopic picture where laparoscopy is being done. It can be done for diagnostic purposes or for the surgical removal. So here you can see this is the surface of uterus, and this is a fibroid on the surface of uterus. So it will be subserosal. Subserosal fibroid or subserosal leiomyoma. Now again, in this picture, you see this is intramural. It is seen within the myometrium. So this is intramural fibroid. This is intramural fibroid. This is like submucosal. This is subserosal. So these are different kinds of fibroids. This is subserosal. And this one is also intramural. Now, the infrequent sites of leiomyoma are uterine ligaments, and it can also be seen in case of cervix, where we call it cervical leiomyoma in 3% of the cases. Now we come to the morphology, which is very, very important. So morphology, first gross examination, like naked eye examination of the tumor. So what are the different features that are seen grossly? So leiomyoma is round, its shape is round. It is well encapsulated because it is a benign tumor, so it is well encapsulated tumor. So we can see the capsule outside. See, this is the capsule. This shiny thing is capsule. This is a capsule, and it is showing prominent vascular markings and some areas of hemorrhage. So this is well encapsulated tumor, and it is discrete and it is sharply circumscribed. So you can see its boundary. It is sharply circumscribed tumor, and when we touch it, then consistency will be firm in consistency. And color is grayish white, and size can vary from small nodules to large masses which fill the pelvis. So these are the some important gross features. So it will be round, well encapsulated, discrete, sharply circumscribed, grayish white in color, and size can be small to large. And another very, very important feature which is seen in gross examination is that on cut section, the fibers, the muscle fibers, they show a whorl pattern. Whorl pattern, this is a, like this. This is the whorl pattern of fibroid. You can see the muscle fibers which are running in this cut section. So running like waves. So this is called the whorl pattern. See, this is the whirling. It is a characteristic pattern which is seen in leiomyoma. So it is a very important question which is asked in Viva also. So this is the longitudinal section of uterus, and you can appreciate that this is the endometrial cavity which has been compressed by this large intramural fibroid. This is a large, and it is, you see, this is round and this is well encapsulated and showing a whirling pattern on cut section. So this is the important finding in case of leiomyoma gross examination. So this is very commonly asked in Viva, because in our practical we have wet mount specimen of fibroid, and you are always asked about it. So another feature of gross examination is that during pregnancy the fibroid undergoes red degeneration. This is an important question. So in the pregnant uterus, the red degeneration is seen in the leiomyoma. And you can see these red congested areas in the cut section of fibroid. And it occurs due to rapid growth in the second trimester. And there will be congested blood vessels, there will be venous thrombosis and hemorrhage in fibroid. So red degeneration occurs during pregnancy. So this is an important question for MCQ for Viva, that when does red degeneration occur? It occurs during the pregnancy in the fibroid. Now another pictures to explain you the gross examination. So this is a what is the name of pattern on the arrowhead? So on the arrowhead you can see these are the muscle fibers bundles, and these are showing the whirling pattern. This is a whirling pattern on the arrowhead. And how to describe the outer surface? See, this is a cut surface of the leiomyoma showing the whirling. See, these are the bands, and this is whirling pattern. And this is the outer surface. Outer surface is well encapsulated. It is smooth, and it is showing focal areas of hemorrhage. So this is how you will describe these specimen grossly, on outer surface and cut surface. You have to describe all these in case of leiomyoma. Now we come to the microscopy of leiomyoma. So leiomyoma shows proliferating bundles of स्मूथ मसल सेल्स, तो स्मूथ मसल सेल्स इट इज़ अ बिनाइन ट्यूमर, सो द सेल्स दे जस्ट लुक लाइक अ नॉर्मल माइमेट्रियम. सो दीज आर द बंडल्स ऑफ स्मूथ मसल सेल्स विच आर प्रोलिफरेटिंग इन द माइमेट्री इन द लियोमायमा. सो दीज आर द बंडल ऑफ स्मूथ मसल सेल्स, दे कैन बी सीन इन लॉन्गिट्यूडनल कट सेक्शन, दे कैन बी सीन इन ट्रांसवर्स कट सेक्शन, और दे कैन बी सीन लाइंग ओब्लीकली. सो हाउ डू वी सी द इंडिविजुअल मसल सेल्स? इंडिविजुअल मसल सेल्स, दे आर मसल सेल्स, दे आर बिनाइन एंड दे आर स्पिंडल इन शेप, स्पिंडल शेप्ड, एंड द न्यूक्लियस हैज ब्लंट एंड, इट इज इलोंगेटेड स्पिंडल शेप्ड, इट हैज ब्लंट एंड्स, ब्लंट राउंडेड एंड्स, एंड इट द न्यूक्लियस गिव्स अ सिगार शेप्ड अपेयरेंस. सो द न्यूक्लियस इज करेक्टरिस्टिकली कॉल्ड सिगार शेप्ड, एंड इट इज ऑल्सो MCQ क्वेश्चन. सो द न्यूक्लियस हैज सिगार शेप हैविंग राउंडेड एंड्स और ब्लंट एंड्स, and they it has long bipolar cytoplasmic processes. So how do we describe a smooth muscle cell? It is a spindle shaped cell having a spindle shaped nucleus. Nucleus has blunt rounded ends and gives a cigar shape appearance, and it has moderate amount of eosinophilic cytoplasm which has long bipolar cytoplasmic processes. So this is the description of smooth muscle cells. So these will be seen in the form of bundles in case of leiomyoma. So another picture, this is a individual smooth muscle cell. In this is depicted here, that it has a elongated nucleus with rounded ends, and it has a cigar shaped nucleus, and the nucleus will be blunt. It will not be hyperchromatic, not be pleomorphic, no irregular nuclear boundaries. So it will be bland, means benign. Benign, it has regular nuclear boundaries. It has bland chromatin. So, and there will be moderate amount of eosinophilic cytoplasm. So pinkish cytoplasm will be there. And there are some immunohistochemical markers by which we can demonstrate the smooth muscle cells. So we do immunohistochemistry for muscle-specific actin, alpha, SMA, desmin, and H-caldesmon. So these are also like MCQ questions. So what are the markers for smooth muscle cells? For any smooth muscle cell in the body, anywhere in the body, so we can use these markers to demonstrate. Now next, in this microscopic picture, we see again these are the benign smooth muscle cells which are having blunt ends of the nucleus, cigar shaped nucleus, and these are the bundles of the smooth muscle cells with cigar shaped nucleus. So another picture of leiomyoma in microscopy. Now next, another picture, this is from the Robbins only. So again, this shows these cigar shaped nuclei, eosinophilic cytoplasm, and this has secondary change. These are some areas of these pinkish areas, these are the areas of hyalinization. So this is a secondary change which can be commonly seen in leiomyoma. Another changes which can be seen are like mucoid change, cystic change. These can be seen in a leiomyoma. Now next, there can be some variation in the microscopy of leiomyoma. So but all these variations, they are benign, nothing to worry about. So what are those variations? First is atypical or bizarre variant of leiomyoma. So in atypical or bizarre variant, we see scattered atypical cells. The cells which are bizarre, they are hyperchromatic, having irregular nuclear boundaries. So the nucleus will be atypical, but it is a leiomyoma, it is not malignant. There will be no mitosis, no increased mitosis, there will be no necrosis. So with these features, we can differentiate it from leiomyosarcoma. Next is cellular leiomyomas, where the cellularity is increased. The cellularity of the leiomyoma is increased. And then there are mitotically active leiomyomas, where there is increased mitosis. But here again, there will be no ATPia, there will be no necrosis. So in this way, we can differentiate it from leiomyosarcoma. So all these three variants, they have to be differentiated from leiomyosarcoma, because the treatment would be different. The approach to the patient would be different in case of a leiomyoma and a leiomyosarcoma. So we need to, whenever these three variants we see in microscopy, we try to differentiate it from leiomyosarcoma. And that will be on the basis of features like ATPia, on mitosis and necrosis. Now next is benign metastasizing leiomyoma. So leiomyoma, sometimes it reaches into the blood vessels, and from there it can reach to distant organs like lungs. But it is a benign condition, it is not malignant. The mechanism is not similar to that in a malignant neoplasm. So it is called a benign metastasizing leiomyoma. And last is disseminated peritoneal leiomyomatosis, wherein we see multiple leiomyomatous nodules in the peritoneal cavity, and it arise in the different places in the peritoneal cavity. We see nodules, and on microscopy there will be proliferation of the smooth muscle cells like leiomyoma, and it is considered to be arising from the metaplasia of the epithelium at those places. So this is called disseminated peritoneal leiomyomatosis, where we see numerous nodules scattered all over the peritoneal cavity. Now we come to the clinical course of leiomyoma. So leiomyoma, if they are small and they can be asymptomatic, but sometimes they may be large, very large in size, and they can cause abnormal bleeding per vaginum. They can cause dysmenorrhea, then they can cause menorrhagia, along with abdominal pain. Abdominal pain is also a feature, and sometimes they present as a pelvic mass because they gain very large sizes. Sometimes they fill whole of the pelvic cavity, and they will cause abdominal heaviness. The patient will feel abdominal pressure and heaviness. She can feel urinary frequency because the enlarged uterus, it will press on the urinary bladder, so she can feel urinary frequency. Sometimes what happens in the subserous pedunculated fibroid, the stalk of the fibroid, it can get twisted, and there can be infarction of a subserosal fibroid, and because of that infarction there can be sudden pain. The patient can feel sudden pain, and then they can be impaired fertility, because the enlarged fibroids, they will interfere with the process of fertility in many ways. We will discuss later. So what happens in a pregnancy? First of all, the leiomyoma interferes in the fertility of the patient. Sometimes leiomyomas, they are present in the, they are submucosal, and they can interfere with the implantation of the fertilized ovum. Sometimes they are too large and they are near the fallopian tube. They can cause the blockade of the fallopian tube, so they can impair the fertility of the patient. Secondly, if a patient gets pregnant, then myoma is also there in pregnancy. Both are coexisting. So what risk the female have? So first of all, they can be increased chances of spontaneous abortion. So the fetus can get aborted when there is coexistent leiomyoma in the uterus. Then secondly, there can be fetal malpresentation. The presentation of the fetus can change because of a leiomyoma, which is causing some certain anatomical changes in the uterus. And third is uterine inertia. The uterus will not contract with that much force during labor like it contracts normally because of the presence of that fibroid. And lastly, they can be postpartum hemorrhage. So these are the complications that can occur if a patient has pregnancy and also coexisting fibroid in the uterus. And another very important point for MCQ and Viva, that how much percent of cases of leiomyomas they can progress to leiomyosarcomas. So it is extremely rare. Extremely rarely the leiomyoma progresses to leiomyosarcoma, and the chances are less than 0.5%. So how do we diagnose leiomyoma? Diagnose with signs and symptoms, per-abdominal, per-vaginal findings. Then we can take help of radiology, ultrasound, MRI, or hysterosalpingography, wherein we inject a dye through the vagina into the uterus, and then visualize it with the help of X-ray images. So this is called hysterosalpingography, and then hysteroscopy can be done to visualize the endometrial cavity, and laparoscopic diagnosis can also be done. So this is a ultrasound image. This is the endometrial cavity, this black thing, and this is a submucosal leiomyoma. So it can be diagnosed on ultrasound. Now for treatment, asymptomatic patient don't need any treatment, but for symptomatics there are many modes of treatment. They can be removed surgically, the fibroids can be removed surgically. Whereas if the patient is near her menopausal age group and she has severe symptoms, then hysterectomy can be considered. And myomectomy is just the removal of the fibroid only. Then uterine artery embolization can also be done. So these are the various treatment modalities. Gonadotropin release hormone analogs can also be given sometimes to decrease the size of fibroids. Now next we come to the leiomyosarcoma. So leiomyosarcomas, they are not that common as leiomyomas. They are uncommon malignant tumors of the smooth muscles of myometrium, and most of the time they arise de novo. They arise as a new, they don't progress from leiomyomas, they arise de novo in most of the cases. The peak incidence is between 40 to 60 years of age. They spread locally, regionally, or by hematogenous route. So they are aggressive tumors. Morphology is a little bit different from the leiomyomas. So they are bulky tumors. They form fleshy masses invading the uterine wall. So cut surface has this fleshy appearance, like this. This is a fleshy appearance of the cut surface. This is strikingly different from the leiomyoma. And sometimes they grow as polypoidal masses and they project into the uterine lumen. They obliterate the uterine cavity. So cut surface can also show areas of hemorrhage and necrosis. So again, you see this is a longitudinal section of uterus and this is showing this leiomyosarcoma with outer surface showing areas of hemorrhage. Again, this picture, longitudinal section, this is uterus body and this is endometrial cavity, which is obstructed by this large tumor. It on the cut surface, it has a fleshy appearance with areas of hemorrhage. You can see this is a cut surface of leiomyosarcoma. And what will we see in microscopy? So it is different from leiomyoma, as the cells, the individual smooth muscle cells, they will show cytological atypia. And the cells, sometimes they are well differentiated. When the cells are well differentiated, they resemble more a benign smooth muscle cell. So in that case, we have to differentiate it from leiomyoma. And sometimes they are highly anaplastic. So distinction from leiomyoma, in case of well differentiated leiomyosarcoma, when the leiomyosarcoma is well differentiated, means the cells, they are kind of resembling the normal smooth muscle cells. So we have to distinguish it from leiomyoma. So it is based on three features. These are the three important features with which we will differentiate leiomyoma from leiomyosarcoma. So first is nuclear atypia. Atypia will be seen in case of leiomyosarcoma. Mitotic index, especially if more than 10 mitotic figures are seen in 10 high power fields, then it is more suggestive of leiomyosarcoma. Then lastly, the zonal necrosis. So necrosis will be seen more in cases of leiomyosarcoma. Now see this image. This is an image of leiomyosarcoma. Here we see these are like you saw in leiomyoma, the cells were cigar shaped, the cigar shaped nucleus were there, the nucleus were absolutely bland, no nucleoli, and chromatin was also bland. So you see, this is leiomyosarcoma. Here you can see nuclear pleomorphism is there. The nuclei are varying in shape and size, and there is prominent nucleoli in the cells. Prominent nucleoli, this blue, dark blue, these are the nucleoli. And here on the arrowheads, these are mitosis. This worm-like thing, this is a mitosis, mitotic figures. So see, there's so much mitosis in this field. So it is an important criteria for diagnosing leiomyosarcoma. So first feature important is cytological atypia. Second is mitosis, which is the most important criteria. This is a MCQ question, that mitosis is the most important criteria for diagnosing leiomyosarcoma. And lastly, necrosis. So I'll show you one more image. This image, this is a leiomyosarcoma with tumor cell necrosis. So you see the cells are proliferating and they are causing necrosis within the tumor. So this is the tumor cell necrosis. Treatment options are surgery, chemotherapy, but recurrence can occur after surgery, and it is a poor prognosis. More than 50% cases, it metastasizes through blood route to distant organs like lungs, bone, and brain. And 5-year survival is also about 40%. So lastly, summary of today's lecture. Endometrial stromal tumors, they include the stromal nodules, which are benign, then low-grade stromal sarcomas and high-grade stromal sarcomas. So stromal tumors, they are well, stromal nodules, they are well-circumscribed tumors. The low-grade stromal sarcomas, they infiltrate into the surrounding myometrium, and they are associated with the fusion of these two genes, JAZF1 and SUZ12. Then high-grade stromal sarcomas, they show marked atypia, and they are associated with other gene fusions. So, and both low-grade and high-grade stromal sarcomas, they are prone to late recurrences. Then leiomyomas, which they are common, benign, smooth muscle tumors, they are one of the most common tumors which are seen in the female, and they cause significant morbidity and often associated with mutations, namely MED12. Then leiomyosarcomas, they are malignant smooth muscle tumors, they are uncommon tumors, and they are highly malignant myometrial tumors, and usually arise de novo. and leiomyomas, they progress to leiomyosarcomas in only less than 0.5% of the cases. So these are the references. Thank you very much for listening.